And she decided after 3 years, maybe she has to go home and face the music back in Fairbanks, where she ran away from. And along the way, she's picked up a best friend. So in a lot of ways, this is a passage about best friends and the role they play in our lives and in our novels, because when you run into a best friend character, that's really fun. She can kind of take over a scene, as Lisa does in this scene. Annie doesn't know Lisa all that well. And they just arrived after a torturous journey from Key West to Alaska. You can't imagine. I looked up the airplane flights. It's just painful. So they're just getting in. It's sunset in Alaska, so that means it's about 11 o'clock. They touch down with the glare of the sunset, painting the inside of the plane coral and copper. Annie tamped down the hopeful feeling she had. Nothing had changed. Time had elapsed, and that was all. The Naomi Glacier had advanced less than 10 inches while she'd been gone, and it was possible that people's hearts were just as frozen. Eve's heart had thawed towards someone else. But the light was so welcome to her eyes. The brief flood of air as she crossed the jetway into the terminal seared her sinuses and throat. Forget the aircraft diesel, the cloying oil of machinery. This was air. Real air in her lungs, after so long. What's the hurry? Lisa kept pace with her as she walked rapidly from the gate area toward the terminal doors. Annie burst out of the building into the cooling summer night, gasping like a swimmer surfacing from too long underwater. Filling her lungs, exhaling, filling again. She got dizzy, leaned over, but kept on gulping in fresh, clean air. Hands on her knees, she asked Lisa, "Do you feel it?" "What, fresh air? It's about time. We've been in airports or airplanes for at least 18 hours. I don't think my left ear is ever going to pop." Abruptly, Annie had no control over her legs. "Hey, there's no falling down in airports." Lisa supported her to a nearby bench. "What gives? Come on, put your head between your knees." "I'm okay." "No, you're not. Don't make me get a paper bag for you to breathe through." Annie, her voice muffled by her knees, said, "I knew I'd feel something. I'm just a little surprised." "You're hyperventilating." Between breaths, Annie gasped, "No, I'm not." No wonder she wouldn't listen. "You don't listen either." Lisa smacked her hard on her lower back. Annie's head shot up. "What was that for?" "Broke the pattern, didn't it?" "No hitting. No more hitting. There's no hitting." The world had tilted in Annie's field of vision, but her sense of up and down was starting to align with the angle of the sidewalk. But darned if she'd admit it. "I was getting better before that." "Good. Can we get our luggage now?" In spite of her impatient words, Lisa gave Annie another few minutes to collect herself. The sensation of being drunk on air eased, but she still wanted to smile with every breath. By the time they retrieved their bags and took a shuttle to the car rental counter, it was getting late, even by summer standards. Economics required that she rent them an inexpensive car, and her exhausted body demanded she do it quickly. She was haggling over the model and rate when Lisa derailed the conversation by asking for a cup of water with her water fountain. "I'm afraid of getting myself wet. That the handle thingy is kind of wobbly." The clerk was pleased to hand over a cup and didn't get back to his paperwork until after Lisa had thanked him twice and headed for the fountain. Annie just wanted to sign for the car and go. Lisa was back far too soon to have drunk very much water. "Isn't it great that we're being helped by the manager?" "I'm not the manager," the clerk said, still pushing in buttons. But now, he was blushing. Damn her, she was flirting with the guy, and Anne just wanted to get it over with. She gave Lisa an evil look, which was completely ignored. "Oh," Lisa looked so disappointed. "I was just reading about the manager's specials and all. How do we qualify for one of those if you're not the manager?" "I'm the assistant manager." "Blush, blush, blush. I have some discretion." Lisa literally thumped Annie out of the way with her hip. "We just got here from the Florida Keys. It's sunny and warm there. I don't think I'm going to have much use for my swimsuit or my surfboard." God, the woman could giggle. "So what kind of upgrade could we get, do you think?" The silence in the four-wheel drive, fully automatic, all-weather utility hybrid was profound. They were on Minnesota Drive before Lisa heaved a loud sigh. "I could have gotten us an expedition. This gets way better miles per gallon. I'm just saying there is nearly nothing you can't get from a guy if you squiggle over how big it is. Are you sure you're a lesbian?" "Hey." Lisa's tone lost most of its mirth. I don't tell you how to be a lesbian. Point taken. And thank you again. This is a great car, and yes, for the third time I realized that it's only costing us 20 more a week than that Tic Tac compact they were going to rent me. Annie turned into the lot of the motel where she'd stayed 3 years ago. Its chief recommendation was that it was cheap and clean. Just earning my keep. I can't decide, Annie said slowly, if I like you because you're annoying or because sometimes you stop being annoying. Lisa fluttered her eyelashes. Is there a reason it can't be both? Annie indicated the motel. Maybe you could get us the presidential suite. Lisa gave the establishment the once over. I'm a blonde with boobs, not a miracle worker.